his wife. We have a red box in the entry if anybody would like to contribute toward Christmas treats. We will plan to have our Thanksgiving service this Wednesday evening. We will hold that here in the church. And then again, we'll hold the midweek Advent services in the parish hall. I think that's all I'll announce. We'll continue by singing our opening hymn, "The King Shall Come When Morning Dawns." It's number 348 in the Lutheran Service Book.
Let me know how fleeting I am. Behold, you have made my days. Eternal God, merciful Father, you have appointed your Son as judge of the living and the dead. Enable us to wait for the day of his return with our eyes fixed on the kingdom, prepared for your own from the foundation of the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated. The Old Testament reading for Christ the King Sunday is recorded by the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 34. For this is what the Sovereign Lord says, I myself will search for my sheep and look after them. As a shepherd looks after his scattered flock when he is with them, so will I look after my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places where they were scattered on a day of clouds and darkness. I will bring them out from the nations and gather them from the countries. I will bring them into their own land. I will pasture them on the mountains of Israel, in the ravines, and in all the settlements in the land. I will tend them in a good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel will be their grazing land. There they will lie down in good grazing land, and they will be fed in a rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will tend my sheep and have them lie down, declares the Sovereign Lord. I will search for the lost and bring back the strays. I will bind up the injured and strengthen the weak, but the sleek and the strong I will destroy. I will shepherd the flock with justice. Therefore, this is what the Sovereign Lord says to them. See, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you shove with flank and shoulder, butting all the weak sheep with your horns until you have driven them away. I will save my flock, and they will no longer be plundered. I will judge between one sheep and another. I will place over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will tend them. He will tend them and be their shepherd. I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David will be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is recorded by the Apostle Paul in his first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the firstfruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive, but each in his own turn. Christ the firstfruits, then when he comes, those who belong to him. Then the end will come when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed all dominions, authority, and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For he has put everything under his feet. Now when it says that everything has been put under him, it is clear that this does not include God himself, who put everything under Christ. When he has done this, then the Son himself will be made subject to him who put everything under him, so that God may be all in all. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand as we join to sing the gospel acclamation.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heavenly glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, came to visit me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?' The king will reply, 'I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me.' Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick, in prison, and you did not look after me.' They also will answer, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you?' He will reply, 'I tell you the truth, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me.' Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We join in confessing our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made. For us men, and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ our Lord and our wonderful Savior, Have you ever been someplace where people have prepared for your arrival? Perhaps you went on a business trip or you went to a conference. At the registration table, there was a packet of information for you with a printed name tag. The conference was prepared for your arrival. Maybe you've heard stories of how hotels and resorts will plan for the arrival of a celebrity, a politician, or some other famous person. The resort stocks the celebrity's favorite luxuries or favorite drinks. If the celebrity likes a certain type of exotic food, the hotel or resort makes sure that this food is in hand. The celebrity knows the resort has prepared for his visit. In our text, we hear, as we just confessed, that Jesus is coming to judge both the living and the dead. The Holy Scriptures are full of prophecies regarding the return of the Son of Man on the last day. Judgment Day has been portrayed throughout history with images that create fear and dread. Signs along the interstate and exhortations to get right with God have portrayed this throughout history and have enabled people not to be very wanting for that day to come. Rather, they shudder at the thought. In fact, I recently had a conversation about our scriptures these past couple of weeks, focusing on our Lord's final coming and judgment day. A comment was made something to the effect, is this appropriate, especially at this time with the pandemic and the devastating second wave that is hitting us right now? Well, this is not the image that God intended for his people. The certainty of our Lord's return is intended to bring comfort and peace to God's saints. For those who struggle through this veil of tears, the image of our Lord's return is meant to bring us hope. Jesus is the ultimate heroic figure who comes at the greatest challenge of the struggle to deliver his own to the perfect happy ending of paradise. Our Lord is mighty to save, and that's exactly what he will come to do for those who have faith in him. Many are longing for the day when they will no longer live in fear, considering everything that is going on in our world today. Many are looking forward to that day when they're no longer living with the threat of virus, disease, violence, lawlessness, and even death.
in God's sight. But punishment was not prepared for people from the foundation of the world. Jesus did not decide to save some and damn others, as sadly some Christians do believe. The place of eternal punishment was prepared for the devil and his evil angels for rebelling against God. Hell was not intended for people. Jesus wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. So Christians can eagerly anticipate Jesus' return because of what he has prepared. Jesus' lengthy discourse on his return comes just days before his death. Everything to follow had already been planned, prepared by God from the foundation of the world. By what Jesus would do on Good Friday, he would prepare us for his kingdom. Our Savior has taken the punishment we deserve upon himself as he died on the cross. In exchange, you have now received his righteousness. Every act of love he has done is counted as yours. Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" The king will reply, "I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me." Because of our Lord's victory over the devil, sin, and death, through his life of obedience, crucifixion, and resurrection, his kingdom, prepared for the foundation of the world, is also yours. Our Lord tells us he has prepared a kingdom for us, for our comfort. We need not fear his return, because he has forgiven all your sins. You will be found there at his right hand. You will receive the kingdom he has prepared for you. For he loved you so much, he planned your salvation and your reward before the foundation of the world was set. You're the guest that God has been waiting to receive for a long time. In fact, even before time began. Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, in faith, we long to see Jesus. Until the day of his return, we eagerly wait, and we do so with hope and confidence. Our Lord reigns among us through the preaching of the message of his cross. He has forgiven us, his beloved children, all our offenses. So we, being governed by his bountiful goodness, may enter at last into his eternal paradise. May this faith and hope sustain you while you journey this side of heaven, and as you look forward to the final fulfillment of God's promise to you at the return of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, our King. Amen. Now may the peace
prayer, O Lord, and give ear to my cry.
Hold not your peace at my tears.
Heavenly Father, enthroned in glory, in your mercy and grace, we pray for your people in this place, for the mission and work you have given us to do, and for the unity of the Spirit and a spirit of cooperation and harmony in our life together. For all the schools of our church, Father, for the seminaries where our pastors are being trained for your service, and for the campuses where our young are prepared for their occupations in their callings as your people by baptism and faith. For those who have wandered from the flock of God, for the faithful shepherds who gather them in through the voice of God's word, for our forgiveness, and for our willingness to forgive others in your Son's name. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and give ear to my cry.
Hold not your peace at my tears.
Heavenly Father, enthroned in glory, in your mercy and grace we pray for President Trump, Governor Parson, and all in authority over us, that they may not abuse the trust and power placed in their hands, but use it honorably and for the good of all people. For all artists and artisans, for science and invention, for those who serve in the medical arts, for tradespeople and laborers, and for those who serve and protect us as police, firefighters, and military personnel. Furthermore, we ask you for the hungry and homeless, for the unemployed and underemployed, for those who work in disaster relief, and for the social service agencies of our church, including Lutheran Family and Children Services and LCMS Human Care. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and give ear to my cry.
Hold not your peace at my tears.
Heavenly Father, enthroned in glory, in your mercy and grace we pray for those afflicted by illness of body or mind, and for those who care for them, especially John, Gladys, Brad, Reverend Rod, as he will have heart valve replacement surgery tomorrow. Danny, Glenn, Claude, Lily, Emma, Gary, Sherry, Kathy, Stephen, Bonnie, Sherry, David, Helen, Jimmy, Paisley, Rhonda, Bill, Freeman, Shirley, Ken, Reverend Torreson, Ron, Larry, all who are still dealing with recovery from the effects of violence and natural disasters, all affected by the ongoing pandemic and its effects, including the residents and staff of the Lutheran Home, and those having to deal with quarantine, and all those we now name before you in our hearts. Supply them with your strength and healing, that they may be kept through patience and delivered to everlasting life. Furthermore, we seek your comfort and care for the grieving, especially the families of Pam and Julie, that they may have hope, and for those near the end of their earthly lives, that they may be sustained in faith to everlasting life. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and give ear to my cry.
Hold not your peace at my tears.
Heavenly Father, enthroned in glory, in your mercy and grace, we pray as we remember the sufferings and death of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, for ourselves. look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
A close